If you must have been watching a few of my previous videos, you definitely know about my recent move from Arch to Debian. I've already covered most of the aspects of the switch across a few videos, except for the actual installation itself. In this video, we'll install a minimal Debian system, almost the way I did on my primary machine. I've already mentioned dbootstrap a few times in my previous videos, and I also talked about how it can be used to create a Debian installation on top of another Linux system, which might not even be Debian. Though many of us won't find it that exciting because it involves tens of commands typed over the terminal, it's more of a blessing for the rest of us who like to have a tighter control over their Linux right from the installation. One of the few reasons to make a video on this topic is that there aren't as many resources online about installing Debian over the command line as many as there are for other Linux distributions like Arch. But then one would ask, why would you install Debian in such a difficult way when it already comes with a graphical and otherwise at least a text-based installer, effectively making all this effort useless? Why would someone be willing to go through all this pain of typing commands over a terminal and then eventually achieving a setup that is more or less the same? A short answer to this might be just because one can, but otherwise I'd say there could be very specific things that one would want in their Linux setup that might not be possible through a graphical installer, a very good example being my own case. With all that out of the way, let's talk about the things we need for the installation. To keep things simple and quick, we'll install a very lean setup of Debian without a windowing system or any other software packages. We'll use WirtManager, which is a pretty cool alternative to VirtualBox for running virtual machines. We'll also have a very minimal file system table, just enough to have a running Debian system. Skipping all the regular and boring stuff, I'll quickly create a virtual machine in WirtManager, choose the Debian Live ISO to boot into, select EFI as the boot firmware, and skip right to the point where the boot is complete. The installation, as you might expect, may look very similar to an Arch installation. Along with a few other differences, there will be a few additional steps as well that are otherwise taken care of by Arch tools when you install Arch. So without wasting any more time talking, let's have some demo. So once we boot into live Debian, we jump straight into a terminal and switch user to root. Now that we are root, it'll be easier to continue with the installation. A typical Linux installation starts with connecting to a network. However, we are running a virtual machine and we don't need to worry about it, more specifically connecting to a wireless network, as we just can move along with the fact that our virtualization software takes care of it for us. Before the installation, the first obvious step would be to prepare the file system according to our needs. Though my usual setup is not as simple, for the scope of this video, let's skip to a simple partition map containing a boot, a swap, and a single partition to hold Linux. Needless to say, you can obviously scale this up and add more entries in the file system, but all that is pretty common such that there are plenty of examples all over the internet and hence we won't do it for this exercise. We can use cfdisk to perform the partitioning in a relatively effortless manner. We create a new GPD partition table, and then we create a new partition of 512 MB, set it as EFI. Then we choose to create another one with a size of 2 GBs and select Linux swap. Finally, we choose the leftover space as a regular Linux file system. Let's make sure we write the changes to the disk before proceeding. Let us now format the partitions. We start with formatting the EFI partition as FAT32. Then we format the second one as Linux swap. And then finally the last one as an ext4. Again, I would have gone with BTRFS, but to limit the number of steps and also to keep things simple, let's choose ext4 for this exercise. One thing to note here is that my devices are named VDA and yours could either be SDA or NVMe, depending on the type of hardware. so you'll have to make sure you change the commands you run accordingly. You can simply check what your drives look like using lsvlk. Once we have all that we need, we can start mounting the partitions appropriately. Let's mount the root partition first. Then we create a directory for boot EFI. And then mount the EFI partition. And then we finally set swap. This takes care of mounting all partitions and we are pretty ready for the installation. Depending on what operating platform you're running the installation from, the way you obtain dbootstrap may be different. As we are currently running Debian itself, it could be installed as apt install dbootstrap. We just have to make sure we have the latest package metadata first, and then we can install dbootstrap. With all the partitions mounted and with dbootstrap in hand, we can start the installation right away. So we say dbootstrap include Linux image AMD64, grub EFI, locales, and then we specify the architecture to be AMD64. We say we want bullseye on /MNT. This command assumes that we're installing Debian 11 bullseye on a 64-bit system, which should be okay for most of us, or at least for the sake of a demo like this. This step takes a while depending on several things like the computer, the network speed, etc. We can fast forward to the completion of this step, after which we'll have a base system ready. Before we root into the installed base system, we need to perform a few things. We copy the /etc/mtap file from the host system to the new system. And then we bind a few virtual file systems to avoid issues that we might otherwise encounter during the installation. These are a few things that are automatically taken care of while installing Arch with packstrap and then rooting into the system using archchroot. Regardless, with all this taken care of, we should be good to proceed. We can create the /etc/fstab file manually, but that would be a little cumbersome and also error prone. To save some time and also make sure we're not messing things up, let's do it in a smarter way. We can use /genfstab to generate the file for us. As we're running Debian, we could install the package named arch install scripts through apt. So that would be apt install arch install scripts. Once installed, we can run /genfstab over /MNT to get an /etc/fstab file. With this, we didn't have to type anything manually and yet we have a proper fstab file. Now that we have everything ready inside our freshly installed base system, we can now safely root into it. So we say chroot /MNT /binbash. The command is pretty similar to how we usually root into an Arch system using archchroot. Once executed, the next commands we'll type will be run in the new system. Let us start with updating our apt sources to include non-free software. This won't be needed for the software packages we'll be installing as a part of this exercise, and you can choose not to do it, but I'm doing it here just to show you that one can just in case. Let's use nano to open /etc/apt/sources.list. You can obviously use any other text editor to edit this file. We just need to add a couple of keywords at the end of the line, contrib and non-free. Once done, we press Ctrl O and Enter to write the file and then Ctrl X to exit. Then we run an update on package indexes or indices to be grammatically correct. And that's all. With the apt sources correctly set up, we can install the software we need, but our aim isn't to set up a daily driver here. So let's just install what we absolutely need for the rest of the installation. We install firmware Linux, sudo vim and neofetch. I'm just including NeoFetch for us to be able to see a report after the installation is complete. For setting up the time zone, we can run dpkg reconfigure with TZ data. You can choose a region you live in or would like to live in. I'm choosing Central US. For setting up locales, we can run dpkg reconfigure again with locales. I choose ENUS UDF-8, but you can choose whatever is applicable to you. Next, we set up the hostname of the new machine. Let's call it Titan. Then we configure our hosts file. Let's do this using Vim. Again, you can do this with any other text editor too, including Nano that we used in one of the previous steps. After adding this additional entry, hit escape, then colon WQ and enter. And then we finally configure network interfaces. Let's just save the file and done. Lastly, let's also install a couple of network related packages. To set up user and groups, let's first start with setting up a password for root. And then let's create a non-root user for the system. Let's name her Miranda. So she has a home folder of her own. Her full name is Miranda Lawson and her default shell is bash. Let's set a password for her as well. Finally, let's also add her to the sudo group so she can also run sudo commands. Just as most of our setup was pretty simple, we don't need to do much for the bootloader either. Choosing grub as the bootloader, all that we need to do is to run a grub install. So we say grub install, target is x86-64. We specify the EFI directory and then a bootloader ID as grub. And then we generate grub configs using update grub. That takes care of everything and we can now safely leave the newly installed system. Let's also unmount all mounted file systems. We don't have to worry about the few errors that we see. And finally, let's reboot into the installed Debian system. After the reboot, we have a minimal Debian system that we installed using dbootstrap. Now let's run NeoFetch and see what it looks like. Now that we have a minimal Debian system running, there are several possible next steps one could perform. One can install a windowing system, which can be either Xorg, Wayland, or otherwise, followed by a graphical environment, for which one can use Twiner 2. One can install a few useful software packages that they would need for daily use. However, all that isn't the point of this video, so I'll leave all that to you. All the steps we went through were pretty basic, partly to keep the video simple and short, and then also because I'm not 100% conversant with dbootstrap yet, except for a few times I've used it till this point. I'm sure the tool allows a lot more, but I'll leave that as well for you to explore if at all you're interested. That's all that I have for this video, so let me know if you liked it through either the like, unlike buttons or through your thoughts, feedback, preferably constructive, and ideas in the comments. You may also subscribe to the channel to show me your support and encourage me to make more of such videos. Thanks for watching it till the end. May the maker watch over you. See you in the next video.